हेलो एंड वेलकम एवरीवन टू द डेली न्यूज एनालिसिस ऑफ 25th ऑफ दिसंबर 2023। तो सबसे पहले मेरी क्रिसमस टू ऑल। तो चलिए आज की इम्पोर्टेंट आर्टिकल्स शुरू करते हैं हिंदू पेपर हिंदू न्यूज पेपर से। पहला जो आर्टिकल है, जम्मू एंड कश्मीर पुलिस फाइल मर्डर केस ओवर डेथ ऑफ 3 मैन डिटेन बाय आर्मी। जम्मू एंड कश्मीर पुलिस ऑन संडे रजिस्टर्ड ए मर्डर केस अगेंस्ट अनयूनिफाइड अनआइडेंटिफाइड पर्सन्स आफ्टर 3 मैन पिक्ड अप बाय द आर्मी फॉर क्वेश्चनिंग वेर फाउंड डेड विद मल्टीपल इंजरीज ऑन फ्राइडे। 8 मैन बिलोंगिंग टू द ट्राइबल गुजर बकरवाल कम्युनिटी वर डिटेन्ड फॉलोइंग द एम्बुश ऑन द आर्मी कन्वॉय ऑन December 21st इन द पुंछ रजौरी एरिया वेर 4 सोल्जर्स वेर किल्ड एंड 3 अदर्स वेर इंजर्ड। The terrorists involved in the ambush are yet to be identified or arrested. The first information report has been filed at the Surancourt police station in Poonch under the Section 302 of Indian Penal Code IPC. A government source said the case was registered after a high-level intervention from Delhi following the release of a 29 second video which went viral on social media showing some persons believed to be army jawan stripping the 3 men and sprinkling chili powder on them. The video is said to have been shot at an army camp. Meanwhile, 4 days after the ambush at Dera Ki Gali in Thanamandi area, the army on Sunday released the names of the 4 soldiers killed in the terrorist attack. They are Nike Birender Singh from Chamoli, Uttarakhand, Rafael Man Gautam Kumar from Pauri, Garhwal, Uttarakhand, Naik Karnar, Karan Kumar from Kanpur, Uttar Pradesh, and Rafael Man Chandan Kumar from Nawada, Bihar. The wreath laying ceremony was held in Rajouri on Sunday. The bodies will be flown to their homes and army officials said without providing details about the delay in handling over the bodies to the relatives. As reported, the bodies of 3 of the 4 soldiers were decapitated. It is learnt that families of the soldiers were called to Rajouri to identify the bodies, which were mutilated beyond recognition, and they were requested to hold the last rites there. After the families refused to cremate the boundaries in Rajouri, arrangements were made to fly the bodies to their respective native places. The People's Anti-Fascist Front, a proxy outfit of Pakistan-based terror group Jaish-e-Mohammed, had taken responsibility for the attack and posted photos after the ambush on social media. On Sunday, it released more photos which included the picture of 4 service weapons belonging to the deceased soldiers. It also released screenshots of old post on X, formerly Twitter, of the Prime Minister Narendra Modi questioning the government for not taking strong actions against terrorists. A May 2013 post on X by Mr. Modi was circulated by PAFF on social media app Telegram, said the center is unable to give a strong answer to Pakistan's inhuman act beheading of our soldiers, and now Sarabjit's death are 2 recent examples. Tanker with Indian crew hit by drone in Red Sea. A carbon-flagged crude oil tanker MV Sai Baba heading to India was hit by a one-way attack drone by in southern Red Sea. The US Naval Forces Central Command said on Sunday the vessel had an all-India crew and is managed by an Indian company. No injuries were reported at approximately 8 p.m. US Naval Forces Central Command receives reports from 2 ships in the southern Red Sea that they were under attack. CENTCOM said on X, USS Lebanon responded to the distress call. It is said the vessel had received a certification from the Indian Register of Shipping. Defense sources said all crew are safe and the vessel is heading towards India, a source said. MV Camp Pluto, which was hit by a suspected drone just outside the Indian exclusive economic zone on Saturday, was being escorted by Indian Coast Guard ship Vikram on Sunday and is scheduled to reach Mumbai on Monday, a Pentagon spokesperson told the Reuters news agency that Camp Pluto was hit by a one-way attack drone fired by from Iran. The twin attacks on Sunday took the number of attacks on commercial shipping by Houthi militants since October 17 to 15 after Sai Baba came under it attack. MV Blamenen, a Norwegian flagged and operated chemical oil tanker, reported a near miss by Houthi one-way attack drone with no injuries or damage reported. Also on Saturday, two anti-ship ballistic missiles were fired into international shipping lanes in the southern Red Sea from Houthi-controlled areas of Yemen, CENTCOM said, adding no ships reported being impacted by the ballistic missiles. Between 3 p.m. and 8 p.m. Sanas time, USS Laban was patrolling in the southern Red Sea as part of Operation Prosperity Guardian OPG and shot down four unmanned aerial drone originating from Houthi-controlled area in Yemen that were inbound to USS Lebanon, it added. These attacks represent a significant scale-up in attacks on commercial shipping from Houthi-held areas of Yemen since the launch of Israel action in Gaza. New Security Initiative. In response to escalation in missiles and drone attacks originating from Houthi-held areas in Yemen, which threatens the free flow of commerce in the Red Sea, U.S. Secretary of Defense Lloyd J. Austin on December 18 announced the establishment of Operation Prosperity Guardian, an important new multinational security initiative under the umbrella of the Combined Maritime Forces and the leadership of its Task Force 153, which focuses on security in Red Sea. Further probe on Camp Pluto attack, a naval explosive ordnance disposal specialist will be boarding MV Camp Pluto on arrival in Mumbai to sanitize the vessel and undertake further investigation, the Navy said in its statement giving the timeline of the incident. The Navy said Camp Pluto was reported on fire after being hit by a projectile likely to be a missile or drone around 7:45 a.m. on Saturday, a naval maritime patrol aircraft flew over the vessel at 1:15 p.m. and established contact with the crew. INS Mormugao established communication with Camp Pluto at 7:30 p.m. to ascertain if any assistance was required. ICGS Vikram, also present at Sanas, was directed to escort the vessel to Mumbai, the Navy added. Next article, the pesticide hazard eating away the life and health of farmer in Maharashtra. Nearly 40 kilometers from Yavatmal town, ringed in by agricultural field is Burising village. It is one of the many villages in Maharashtra where farmers suffer from pesticide poisoning. Hiraman Sayam, 45, a farmer affected by pesticide poisoning in 2017, despairs that his body does not possess the strength as it once did. I woke up feeling breathless and restless, which was followed by fits and seizures. My shivering body gradually turned cold. My cousins tried me to a cot using a rope and sari because I was unable to lie still. They carried me to the Akola Bazar Prathamik Arogya Kendra Hospital and from there I was referred to the Sri Basantru Nayak Government Medical College and Hospital. He recalls he had spread an insecticide based on a seller's recommendations that it would significantly increase his cotton yield. The doctor said he suffered poisoning from pesticide that entered his body through the skin. Seeing that his condition had not improved, I took a loan from people to admit him a private hospital, which cost around 1,16,000, of which 50,000 is yet to be repaid, his wife Archana told the Hindu. Her husband had lost his appetite, and doctors are unable to say if the consultant spells of dizziness, headaches, and body pain would be cured. Formerly a homemaker, Mrs. Archana has had to work on their 3-acre farm. After all this, the family continues to depend on pesticides. Global criticism. In 2017, reports of pesticide poisoning emerged from Maharashtra, drawing global criticism against India's pesticide regulation policies. The non-profit Pesticide Action Network India, in its 2017 reports titled Pesticide Poisoning in the Yavatmal District in Maharashtra, Untold Realities, highlighted cases of death by pesticide poisoning in 2017-18 after a large number of cases emerged. The distribution and sale of certain insecticides was prohibited for 60 days in Akola, Amravati, Buldhana, Vasim, and Yavatmal district. The pesticides in Hiraman Syam family said they used are not yet banned in India. Dr. D. Narasimha Reddy, advisor Pan India, said monocrotophage is exclusively used in Maharashtra for white fly as well as to boost plant growth. It is not licensed for uses of on food crops, but farmer use it unknowingly in Yavatmal monocroptos and polo were named by even a government task force committee in 2017-18. In 2021, Pan International released a list of highly hazardous pesticides, of which over 100 are currently approved for use in India. The Maharashtra government introduced a bill in Legislative Assembly on August 8, 2023 to amend the Insecticides Act 1968 in the state. This is quite a surprise given that the proposed amendment is very focused and that problem which it tries to address is not new. Though this amendment, the government admits that misbranded or substandard pesticides are being manufactured and sold in the state. Through the bills, the government is seeking to punish the manufacturer and sell the adulterated, non-standard and misbranded insecticides. The amendment simply put want punishment to be consistent and non-bailable. We urge the government to address other challenges as well, Dr. Reddy said. Goodbye to pesticides. About 20 km from Yavatmal in Subhash Sharma's 16-acre farm in Tisawa village, Mr. Sharma, a septuagenarian, stopped using pesticide in 1994. In the 1990s, 20 cows died grazing in a farm sprayed with pesticide. This spooked me because I was also regularly spraying forets an insecticide which had an unbearable stink. Apart from monocrotophos, Ecallox, an insecticides and many others, Mr. Sharma, who suffered several health issues at the time, said when he read about a legendary Japanese natural farmer Masanobu Fukuoka. He opted the practice only natural farming in 2018. The Maharashtra government set up the Dr. Panjabaru Deshmukh Organic Agricultural Mission, named after the veteran farmer leader Panjabaru Deshmukh, to promote organic farming. The first phase of the mission was introduced in districts with higher incidence of farmer suicides. Buladahan, Akola, Vasim, Amravati, Yavatmal, and Vardha. Since 1994, a non-profit Sarvanatha Vaghadi Farmer Producer Company Limited has been training farmers in several districts to use organic fertilizers. Meenakshi Sawalkar, Director SWFPCL, said they were currently supporting 300 farmers, but they had a long way to go. Health officials from the Sri Basantaro Nayak Government Medical College in Yavatmal said that there was no antidote अवेलेबल इन द मार्केट फॉर मोस्ट ऑफ द पेस्टिसाइड पॉइजनिंग केसेस एंड विक्टिम्स ऑफन डाइड अंडर अनट्रीटेड द हॉस्पिटल डिक्लाइंड टू शेयर इट्स रिकॉर्ड्स ऑन पेस्टिसाइड पॉइजनिंग विद द हिंदू। नेक्स्ट नेक्स्ट आर्टिकल है इंडिया जॉब क्राइसिस द माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक रीजन्स। देर आर मेनी इंडिकेशंस एवरीवेयर दैट द इंडिया कंटिन्यूज टू बी गोइंग थ्रू ए जॉब क्राइसिस क्रिश ऑफिशियल डाटा सोर्सेज एज वेल एज मेनी ऑन द ग्राउंड रिपोर्ट्स पॉइंट टू द दिस फैक्ट। व्हाट आर द माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक रीजन्स फॉर दिस क्राइसिस। द सिम्टम्स ऑफ लो लेबर डिमांड्स एट द आउटसेट इट इज यूजफुल टू डिस्टिंग्विश द टू टाइप्स ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट दैट प्रिवेल्स इन एन इकोनॉमिक सच एज इंडिया। द फर्स्ट इज वेज एम्प्लॉयमेंट व्हिच इज ए रिजल्ट ऑफ लेबर डिमांडेड बाय एम्प्लॉयर्स इन द रिजल्ट इन देयर परस्यूट ऑफ प्रॉफिट। द सेकंड इज ए सेल्फ एम्प्लॉयमेंट वेयर लेबर सप्लाई एंड लेबर डिमांड आर आइडेंटिकल दैट इज द वर्कर एम्प्लॉय हरसेल्फ। ए फर्दर यूजफुल डिस्टिंक्शन कैन बी ऑल्सो बी मेड बिटवीन वेज लेबर एंड जॉब्स। द फर्स्ट For the first incident, the first includes all forms of labor done for an employer, including daily wages, work at one extreme and highly paid corporate jobs at others, but job generally refer to relatively better paid regular wages and salaried employed. In other words, all jobs are wage laborers, but all wage laborer cannot be called jobs. When we spoke of a job problem, we are speaking of inadequate labor demand, particularly for regular wage work. The Indian company economy has historically been characterized by the presence of both open and unemployment, as well as high level of informal employment consisting of the self-employed as well as casual wage workers. The last is also called distinguished unemployment because being similar to open unemployment is also a lack of adequate employment opportunity in the formal sector. This lack of opportunity is reflected by the more or less stagnant employment growth rate of salaried workers in the non-agricultural sector in the last four decades. What explains such constraints in the labor demand of a formal sector? The labor demand in the formal non-agricultural sector is determined by two distinct factors. First, since farms in the formal sector hire workers to produce output for profit, labor demand depends on the amount of output that farms are able to sell. Under any given levels of technological development, labor demand in the formal sector rises when demand for output rises. Second, labor demand depends on the state of technology that dictates the number of workers that firms need to hire to produce one unit of output. Introduction of labor savings technology enables firms to produce the same amount of output by hiring a lower number of workers. Since economic policy is generally framed in terms of output growth, think of GDP and or value added rather than the level of output. Let us examine this argument in terms of growth rates. Unemployment growth rate is determined by the relative strength of two factors, the output growth rate and the labor productivity growth rate. A growth rate of output per worker. If labor productivity growth rate does not change, the higher the output growth rate increases employment growth rate. In other words, policies that promote higher economic growth would also achieve higher employment growth. On the other hand, if labor productivity growth rate rises, employment growth rate falls for a given output growth rate. In India, the employment growth rate of formal and non-agricultural sector remained unresponsive despite a significant rise in the GDP during the 2000s compared to the decade of 1980s and 1990s. The lack of responsiveness of employment growth rate of changes in output growth rate reflects a phenomenon of jobless growth. It indicates a strong connection between labor productivity growth rate and output growth rate. Why should this be the case? Jobless growth with Indian characteristics as an economy grows, it is generally seen that it also becomes more productive. That is in the process of producing a greater amount of total output per worker. This happens because of what economics or calls economies of scales. As firms produce more output, that they find it easier to adopt labor saving technology, but the extent to which labor saving technology are introduced depends on the bargaining power of labor. We can make a distinction between two types of jobless growth regime based on the tightness of the connection between output growth and labor productivity growth. In the first case, the responsiveness of labor productivity growth rate or to output growth rate is weak. The possibility of jobless growth in this case emerges exclusively on account of automation and the introduction of labor saving technology. But the employment growth rate in such regime would necessarily increase if output growth rate happens to increase. Under weak responsiveness of labor productivity, the positive effect of GDP growth rate on employment would dominate over the adverse effect of labor saving technology. Here, the solution to the job crisis is just more rapid economic growth. In the second case, which happens to be the Indian one, the responsiveness of labor productivity growth rate to the output growth rate is high. Here, the positive effect of output growth rate on employment fails to counteract the adverse effect of labor saving technology. Employment growth rate in such regimes cannot be increased simply by increasing GDP growth rate. The extent to which labor productivity growth rate responds to output growth rate is reflected by what is termed as the Kaldor-Burdon coefficients. In a recent working paper, we saw that India's non-agricultural sector is characterized by a higher than average Kaldor-Burdon coefficient as compared to the other developing countries. It is this distinct from form of jobless growth regime in India that makes India's microeconomic policy challenge qualitatively different from other countries. Macroeconomic policy framework. The central contribution of Keynesian revolution in microeconomics was to highlight the role of aggregate demand as binding constraint on employment. Fiscal policy was pursued to increase labor demand by stimulating output. The developing countries that inherited a dual economic structure during their independence confronted additional constraints on output. The Mahalanobis strategy identified the availability of capital goods as the binding constraint on output and employment, putting forward the policy for heavy industrialization. The structuralist theories based on the experiences of developing countries highlighted the possibility of agrarian constraints and the balance of payment constraints. Both these constraints led to key policy debates in India, particularly during the decade of the 1970s and the early 1990s. Nonetheless, what remained common to all these different framework was the presumption that increasing the output growth rate in the non-agricultural sector would be a sufficient condition for increasing the employment growth rate in the formal sector. But the evidence suggests that the employment challenges can no longer be met only through more rapid GDP growth. Rather, a separate policy focus is needed on employment. In addition to the focus on GDP growth, such employment policies will need both demand side and supply side components. For example, to extend family farms in India find it easier to automate due to a lack of adequate skilled labor. Increasing the quality of workforce through better public provisioning of education and healthcare, as well as bringing the skill gap, are important. On the demand side, direct public job creation will be needed. Financing such expenditures while maintaining debt stability requires the reorienting of the current microeconomic framework in a significant way, including the increasing direct tax to GDP ratio by reducing exemption and improving compliance and more imaginative use of macro policy to pursue a constructive economic agenda. So friends, this is all for today, and we will meet from tomorrow onwards with new news articles from the Hindu newspaper. So till then, keep studying. Thank you a lot.